Benefactor underwriting for this broadcast has been provided by a grant from Republic Bank, the power of red is back. Major underwriting support for this broadcast has been provided by grants from New York Community Bank, M&T Bank, Perfect Building Maintenance, Customers Bank, Collins Building Services, Marks Paneth. Additional underwriting support has been provided by grants from AmTrust Title, Bank of America, Capital One Bank, Douglaston Development Levine Builders, Flushing Bank, Friedman LLP, Handrow Properties LLC, Handler Real Estate Organization, Investors Bank, James D. Kuhn Real Estate Institute at Syracuse University, John Kessimatidis Red Apple Group, New Banks, Meridian Capital Group, Ocean First Bank, RPW Group, TD Bank, The One Stop Property Group, and these friends. Germany, Israel, New York, entrepreneur, professor, teacher. That's Michael Strauss. I'm happy to have him today. Michael, thanks for being here.
Well, my pleasure. My pleasure. I look forward to it.
So tell me about the family. You know, let's talk about the time about your grandparents and then talk about Israel and then follow up with that. Let's go back to your grandparents.
In fact, I only knew my grandmother on my father's side when I arrived in America. My parents were born in Israel, in Germany. My mother's parents were born in Poland. My father's parents were born in Germany. He is fourth generation German. They grew up in Germany. My mother was a noted pianist in Germany. In fact, she was the teacher for Henry and Walter Kissinger when they were 5-6 years old. And my dad came from his father, my grandfather was a surgeon in Germany. He unfortunately passed away before my dad even met him when my grandmother was in her seventh month. My father was the youngest, youngest of three sons. And they both went together in the 1930s.
So Michael, how did your parents get the visa to leave Germany to go to Palestine?
My father was a member of a Jewish organization. He was very much involved. And apparently one day they received a few visas for married couple to go to Israel. He was not married. He was going out with my mother that intended sometime in the future to get married. But he literally went home to her house that afternoon. They got married, and the next day they left. That's how quickly it happened.
But they left with nothing, as what you said to
literally,
me.
Literally, yes, as I believe I mentioned to you, with their shirt on their backs. They left with nothing. They didn't have, they couldn't take anything out. They were allowed to leave with a minimal amount of money and some clothing. That's it.
And what year was this?
This was in 1935.
Okay, so this is 1935, and they end up in Haifa, correct?
Correct. They went to Palestine. They end up in Haifa. My mother had a sister living in Haifa, and that was the reason that they went to Israel. They had a choice of going to Israel or to the United States and chose to go to Haifa. Yes, correct. In Haifa, 1956, what happened basically is that I went to a public school, and I was a good student at public school. But they didn't have any financial means. And in Israel at that time, at least, high school was as expensive as college was. And they couldn't afford to send me to college. They wanted to send me to college. My sister chose not to go. So they decided to, they were fortunate enough that my father had a brother in America, and he was willing to sponsor them. So we left, my mother and I and my father left in 1956 for New York.
It's 1956 and you're you come to America. Talk to me about where you came to America, the three-bedroom apartment that had three families and so on, and your first job.
So the three-bedroom apartment actually was in Israel. I grew up in an apartment in Israel, which in Israel, at least in those days, when we talk about a three-bedroom apartment, it's a three-bedroom apartment and a kitchen, no living room, no den, etc. And there were three strange families that I grew up, each in one of these bedrooms. So we had one bedroom, it was my sister, my mother, and I, for 14 years, we slept in that one room. I think in today's age, my kids, certainly my grandchildren, can't even conceive of it. But there was no heating, there was no hot water, no natural gas. I took a shower once a week, and if I didn't have a specific time that I had to take a shower, and if I wasn't there, I missed it. So I had to miss a week. So it was different than today. Let me put it that way.
But similar, when you came to America, things weren't easy either. When you were living at 3657 Broadway between 150th and 151st Street.
Correct. When we came to America. Again, my parents had no money. I believe at that time they were allowed to take $10 out of $10 a person out of Israel. We came to America. We were able to rent a room. I don't even want to call it a one bedroom. It's a room in as you said, 3657 Broadway, which was an apartment. There was a building. Primarily had offices in the building, and this particular floor had an office, a big book bindery. And they had an empty room, and we were able to rent it very, very cheaply. In fact, that was the first time I ever saw a TV. I saved enough money to buy a television for, I think it was $129. I'm not sure, but anyway, I've never had a TV before then. You know, my parents did not have any work. My dad was looking for a job. So I found out, I didn't speak any English. I knew a few words, but I was able to communicate enough to find out that some of the young people were able to make some tips. If they went down a couple of blocks, there was a supermarket there. And I went down to the supermarket and was standing by the cash registers. And when elderly men and women were getting packages, and there was no parking lot there, this is Broadway, people came there three, four, five blocks to do the shopping. I would offer to carry their orders to their home. And when I got to their home, they tipped me. And that's the way I was able to make some money for the first couple of weeks until I got my, I felt my way around where I, my new home.
Now your father got a job with General Diaper in Queens, right? As an auto mechanic.
Yes, initially he had one or two auto mechanic jobs before, but he then got a job in Queens and General Diaper Service because he when he was in Israel he worked at the Shell Oil Company also as a mechanic, and his boss came to America and ironically enough became the manager at the General Diaper Service, so he hired my dad.
So you went to George Washington High School, you excelled in German and math, and then you found Mount Freedom, New Jersey. Let's talk about, you know, the Ackerman's Hotel, where you were a man of many skills.
At the end of high school, I was all about making some money. And I met an individual who, in fact, I just saw this past Sunday, was still my friend after all these years. And he, his family had another hotel in Mount Freedom called Messer's Hotel. And Mount Freedom, New Jersey, basically was the New Jersey Catskills. And he introduced me to the owner at Ackerman's Hotel. And I became a busboy there. During the Passover holidays, basically, they were looking for busboys. And I went there as a busboy. And as a matter of fact, that's when I met my current wife.
After George Washington, you went to the City College for industrial engineering.
Correct. Yeah, I went to City College. I went uptown 2 years. Actually, I wanted to become an electrical engineer, and pretty quickly I realized that that's really not what I what I'm interested in. So I spent 2 years uptown And then went downtown to Baruch, to City College downtown, Baruch School. And while the degree itself is a bachelor's of business administration, the combination of the 2 years of engineering, 2 years of business, gave me the equivalent of an industrial engineering degree.
So you graduate in what, June of 1964?
June of 1964, correct.
Okay, and then you immediately apply to Baruch for your MBA. You want to get your MBA.
Correct. Correct. I got married actually the day after my graduation, and I immediately wanted to get my MBA. Knowing my personality, I was afraid that if I go out to the business world and wait a year or two, as other friends of mine did, I would never get back and do it. So I applied for my MBA, and I 3 years at night, basically after work, I went and got my MBA.
So your first job was what, with the New York Central Railroad?
Yes, I most people, I assume, listening to this broadcast wouldn't even know what the New York Central Railroad was. It's a predecessor to Amtrak, became Pennsylvania Railroad and Amtrak. And I became an assistant industrial engineer at New York Central Railroad. I did that for about a year and a half. And it was pretty clear to me that I didn't enjoy it. But I, in fairness to myself, I felt maybe it was the industry, it was a stodgy industry. So I was able to get a job as an industrial engineer. They called it methods engineer, but at American Airlines, which is a much sexier industry. I did that for a year and a half or so. And
then you had the proverbial New York Times. You found the job in the New York Times, right?
Yes, I went from there to the City Bank. It was First National City Bank. Spent a year and a half at First National City Bank, where I was able to get some operations background, some programming background. And I did that. I was pretty well thought out. At that point, I realized that I really wanted to do something in business. I wasn't sure whether it's going to be for a large company, for myself, whatever. But I determined pretty quickly that to do that, I needed to get some a sense of operations and understanding of programming and understanding of marketing, finance, et cetera. And I was able to get that the following three years or thereabouts at both Citibank and Bank of New York. It was at that point in 1972 that I read the New York Times, and I saw an ad for assistant treasurer at American Express. And the description was vague enough and inclusive enough that I thought I could sell myself to American Express. So I applied, I wrote a letter, I sent, and lo and behold, I had an interview with personnel and with the treasurer, to whom I would report to, and they gave me the job. And here I am at American Express as assistant treasurer.
So let's talk about, you had a very varied career in many divisions in American Express. Let's talk about that, and then American Express Canada, the travel cards and so on.
Right. So I started out as assistant treasurer at American Express. There were a few assistant treasurers, so I wasn't the only one. And the treasury function basically was involved in, looking after the banking relationships of American Express, et cetera. It was all domestic. And I was there for about a year or so. And at that time, there was a very, very large international bank, which was a division of American Express, AEIBC, American Express International Banking Corporation. They had an international treasury operation. Very, very unfortunate on a Sunday, plane from, I believe it was from London to Geneva or to Zurich, blew up, basically 120 people dead. And I got a call that following Monday from the head of that division telling me, wanting to see me. I met with him and he said, you heard that this individual, unfortunately, passed away. We need to fill this position. We've heard you're doing a good job. We're very interested. Would you be interested in coming to our division? And I said, I'd be very interested, but I told them right up front that I really know nothing about international finance. That didn't deter them, and they hired me. And I came into the international finance area. And the first thing I did actually was one of our clients was Brown Brothers Harriman. And I actually called up and I asked them, they they every week to have a 2-3 hour session to teach me about foreign exchange, about international treasury functions, so I can, you know, better understand what I'm responsible for. And I did that for about a year and a half, 2 years. And what happened was that during that time, there was strong rumors that the Mexican peso will devalue. The credit card division of American Express, which was the largest division at that time, probably still is today, had a subsidiary in Mexico. And it loaned the subsidiary $20 or $30 million at the domestic, the US interest rates, which was 6%. But in Mexico, if the subsidiary was a standalone operation, they would have to pay 16%. So that was a big exposure that we had. There was strong rumors that the Mexican peso would devalue. And if it did devalue, it would devalue to the extent of 50%. And one of my responsibilities in the international finance function was to make sure that all divisions are properly hedged towards any of these foreign exchange situations. The president of the credit card division, so I presented a plan which would be, you know, which had some expenses associated with it, but which would mitigate the risk. The president of the credit card division was adamantly against it. He was, in terms of organizational structure, he was much higher than I was. He reported right to the president. I really felt very strongly, although the newspapers said, weren't sure necessarily there will be a devaluation, but I wanted to mitigate the risk and just to make it, you know, cut to the chase, so to speak. The I convinced, he was very, very adamantly against it, and basically was even to the point nasty, wouldn't say hello to me in the elevator because he knew I was pushing for that. Bottom line is the treasurer, to whom I reported to, made the decision to hedge. And as it turned out, the Mexican peso devalued by 50%, over 50% at that time. And it was a huge, we saved, the credit card saved tens of millions of dollars. To his credit, the president of the division, literally the day following the devaluation, called me up, asked me to come to his office. I came to his plush, huge office at American Express Towers, and he literally apologized. Told me that he was very apologetic for the way he handled me, no, inexcusable, et cetera, et cetera. And then he asked the question that everybody dreams of hearing at the end. And he said, Michael, how can I help you? And that was a question I was waiting for, because I really wanted to run a business. I didn't know what, and the credit card had the vision, had a tremendous reputation. That was very entrepreneurial. And he answered very quickly, saying that he had the gold card division. The gold card division was not doing well at all. And he had just lost the president of the gold card division, the head of the gold card division. And would I be interested in coming in and taking a look at it? And he assured me, he said, since we're not sure whether we're gonna close the gold card division or not, I assure you that if you come in for 6 months to a year to really dig into it and come up with a game plan, and if in spite of it, we American Express decide to shut it down, I assure you that you will, I will place you someplace else. You're not gonna lose your job. So I was a risk taker, I did it. I said, absolutely, when do I start? And that was the beginning of my, the different positions I had at American Express, and became kind of known as the turnaround guy at American Express.
Right, you were the turnaround guy, and you were the president of Canada, American Express business in Canada. But let's talk about, you decide to finally leave American Express and then really become a turnaround specialist.
Correct.
Let's talk about that.
Yeah, so I decided to leave American Express. While I had a terrific run, I loved it. I was there for 12 years. Did very well financially. I wanted to leave the corporate scene and become more of an entrepreneur, and decided in the ensuing, I guess, 20 years or so, to work with entrepreneurs who had started companies with private equity groups, with some VCs to come in, join them for sometimes 2-3 years, but really not much longer, and help them turn around the business, because that's my mindset. Yeah, I come in 3 or 4 years, tackle what needs to be tackled, and then put the organization some stability, and then move on. So I did that for quite a few years.
Let's talk, with the 5 minutes left, I'd like to talk a little bit about Yeshiva University and Syms School of Business, of what you've been doing there, and then family.
Great. So Yeshiva University, it was really a fluke. Back in 07, I had a small consulting a group, a couple of people reporting to me. I was doing well financially and I enjoyed it. I had total freedom. As I always say, I looked in the mirror in the morning and I said, if I wanted to take a day off, I took a day off. And I went to, actually, there was a close friend of the family who was very lonely. He lost his wife, didn't have any kids. He invited me to his synagogue on a Saturday. I was there and I met one of the professors who was teaching at Yeshiva University. And we talked about, you know, my background, his background. He said, gee, you have an impressive background. I'd love to have you come in and talk to our students. We have a Kukan lecture series. Would you come in? I said, absolutely. I came in one Friday. I spent an hour and a half talking to, there were 50 young men and women sitting in the room. And I have to tell you, I loved it. They were smart, bright, inquisitive, polite, respectful, et cetera, et cetera. But I left. And over the next couple of weeks, I received a call from the then interim dean to come in. They asked me to teach a course. I created a course called basically Turnaround Business Management, which I strategy, Turnaround Business Strategy, which I taught in 07, 08, one course. I was asked to become the entrepreneur in resident, basically helping young men and women and students who have ideas for businesses, but don't have a clue on how to take the idea to the point of launching a business. And I did that and in 2011, I did that while I was working. I came in a couple of hours a week, but I came in, I was really enjoying it. So I came in more time than I needed to. I wasn't getting compensated for it. But anyway, in 2011, there were discussions within Yeshiva University, perhaps merging the Syms School of Business, which has been around since 87, with Yeshiva College. One of the professors here who's been here for many, many years was adamantly opposed to it. He went and talked to the chairman of the Board of Trustees and then to the president, Richard Joel. And they basically told him, okay, and he convinced them that the reason Syms was not doing well, they lost 300 students because there was never any investment in the school in terms of faculty, in terms of curriculum, et cetera, et cetera. And they basically said, okay, we'll make you the dean. He was taken back because he had spent 25 years as he's world renowned for his Jewish ethics, but he's not administrator. But he obviously had a conversation with the then provost who contacted me, called me and asked me to come up and meet with him. I thought the meeting was basically to thank me for all the work I'm doing for Yeshiva, which it was. But then he basically said, look, we want to revitalize the school. Professor Pava has taken over as dean. How would you like to partner with him? We need a businessman to do it. And it was a life-changing moment for me. Set aside the financial aspect of it. I went home and I spoke to my lovely wife, and she said, listen, you're telling me how much you love what you're doing? Do it. Go for it. You only get one shot.
And you've been there the past 10 years running.
I've been there since 2011, and tremendous fun. We've been able to revitalize, grow the school, increase the student body by about 350 some odd, and credited the school.
Let's talk about the jewels of your life. Tell us about your children, your grandchildren.
The jewels of my life. Well, first of all, I'm married to my wife for many, many, many years, over 50 years. She's my best friend. We have two wonderful sons, both doing extremely well. One is in the hedge fund business, and one is in the wealth management business. And we have six as I call them, delicious granddaughters.
You better tell me the names of the granddaughters. It's very important.
Their names of granddaughters are Remy, Gabrielle, Bailey, Jessica, Hannah, and Sophie.
You hit all six. I'm very happy.
I hit all six. And okay. And they're doing very, very well. Sophie, my oldest one, is in the fourth year of going for PhD or in psychology, all the way down to the youngest one who's still junior in high school.
Okay. So I'd like to say it's very fortuitous that, you know, you had to leave Israel because you needed to get into a high school. And you've been a turnaround specialist. You've been a friend. You've done a great job at Yeshiva University, Syskins. And I'm so happy that I was able to profile your life today on Building New York Stories. Thanks again.
Well, thank you. I really enjoyed speaking with you, Michael. And I obviously enjoy our relationship, our friendship.